Queen of Demons, Chaos of the Covenant, Volume 7, written by M.R. Forbes, narrated by Jeff Hayes. 1. The Keeper knew something was wrong. Of course, there were plenty of things wrong. The Covenant had taken heavy fire from the Prophet Azul's warships, along with a pair of strikes from the much more destructive tactical munitions Keeper had configured for the Apocalypse fighters. The outer hull of the shard ship was a mess of bent and torn metal and broken weapon batteries, a tangle of exposed wiring and deep gouges in the core's external nervous system. It was damage that would take days to repair, and Keeper's programming demanded that it fix the mess as quickly as possible. And it would. But there was something else that was far more damaged and required far more attention. It wasn't clear how that part of the Covenant had been compromised. The warheads had hit the surface, and the ship's armor and shielding were certainly powerful enough to prevent much penetration. It was a mystery, one that it was eager to solve. Keeper reached the core, stepping up to the mass of bundled synapses and putting its hand against it. The core had access to data not provided to the external systems. Data only it and the shard could ever reach. It shook its head slightly when it received the results. This was bad. It extracted its hand from the core and broke away at a run. It was a machine, an artificial intelligence, and at the same time, it had some vague concept of emotions, at least as a series of reactions caused by an initiating action. That action had already taken place, and now it was only a question of whether or not it could stop it. It had a bad feeling it couldn't. Its metal feet echoed along the floor of the shard ship, its smooth cadence quickly becoming a solid stream as it moved as quickly as its form allowed. It burst into the shard's tomb, blades forming in its hands, rushing to the source of its distress. Someone was standing in front of the focus. Keeper didn't slow. It continued across the floor, approaching the intruder at full speed. It was only 2 meters away when the figure suddenly turned, the cloak they were using to disguise themselves swinging outward and hardening. Keeper slid against the ground to freeze its momentum. It only partially succeeded. The solid ripples of the cloak slammed into its chest, creating a deep cut and throwing it backward and onto the floor. Keeper didn't remain there. It rolled over and back to its feet, releasing its blades at the intruder, who flicked their wrist and cast them aside. They reached back, placing a hand in the fountain. With their free hand, they pushed Keeper to its knees.
"Where did you come from?"
Keeper asked. It struggled to rise, the force of the gift preventing it from moving easily. The figure's mouth split in an ugly grin, revealing sharp teeth. He was old, worn, wrinkled, his skin tight against his bones and covered in stains. He was wearing a serif suit, one of the originals, his name on a patch over his breast, nearly worn away by time.
"I've been here, Keeper," he said.
His voice was ragged, as though it hadn't been used for thousands of years. Because it hadn't.
"You just weren't looking hard enough."
He removed his hand from the focus, using both to lift Keeper to its feet. Keeper walked toward him, no longer in control of its body.
"I know you discovered the anomaly,"
the intruder said.
"Your mistake was letting her bring the Covenant here. It was what he wanted."
"I am programmed to follow the directives of the Chosen,"
Keeper said.
"I had no choice."
The man laughed.
"I know. And yet, you tried to stop her, didn't you? You tried to convince her not to allow the Asura off the ship."
"She wouldn't listen."
"Unfortunately for her,
she is stubborn."
"Unfortunately for you, she didn't know there was more than one reason why they were here. Charmaine was trying to play games. She should have told the Chosen everything."
"She has told no one everything. Not even me."
"And look where it's gotten her. Look where it's led all of the Arch-Chancellors, all of the Seraphim, and now the so-called Light of the Shard. To failure, to defeat. The Father knew this day would come. He promised the Covenant would be ours one day. He promised we would go home. Not to die, but to free our people.
The One does not seek to destroy those who return.
That's what your programming tells you. But you're a machine. You only know what you've been told. I can't blame you for that. I was there, Keeper. You remember me. I know. Even if the years have turned my body into this, even the blood of the Shard couldn't spare me from the wrath of time. Not completely. I believed in the One when the war came. For years, I held out hope that he would save us. And then the first transversal proved what Lucifer had long suspected. We have never been free.
You are wrong. You have always been free.
Not yet. But soon, we will be. Soon, all of us will be.
You are wrong again. You are not strong enough.
I'm not, the intruder admitted. But the Father is.
He glanced back at the focus.
Especially now.
Keeper was silent, calculating. This could not be so, and yet all of the data suggested that it was.
I will stop you.
You had your chance, Keeper, the man said. It's too late now.
Keeper's eyes shifted to the focus. If it had been capable of fear, it might have been afraid. If it had been capable of anger, it might have been angry. The blood of the focus was no longer the milky white the Chosen had returned it to. It once more ran red, a deeper red than he had ever seen before.
The Father is revived, Keeper, the man said. War is coming to Elysium. You're going to help us bring it there.
It is not within my operational parameters.
Your parameters are changing.
Keeper knew it was true. It could sense the assault on the core, the hidden code making itself known after all of these countless years. Lucifer's code, implanted during his original sin and activated at last by the traitorous Seraphim. The Arch-Chancellor, Judas. It felt the gift recede from it, allowing it control once more. For a moment, it desired to charge Judas, to wrap its hands around the betrayer's throat and squeeze until his head exploded. But only for a moment. The desire left him as the core was updated and overtaken. It put its arms at its sides instead.
That's better,
Judas said, smiling again.
What is your command?
Keeper asked.
I will give you the coordinates, Judas said. Take me to the Father.
2. Abby licked the last vestiges of Azul's blood from her lips. Her entire body was tingling, electrified by the introduction of the additional nanites into her system. She could feel the change in her power. She could sense how it had grown. She felt alive, in a way that was both exhilarating and dangerous. Where was Bastion? At the moment, she wanted to give him what he wanted. It was better that he wasn't there. She rose to her feet, turning back toward the masses gathered around her. Her eyes fell on Gant first. His expression was flat, but she knew he was disgusted by what she had just done. He had every right to be. They all did. Of course, they weren't all opposed to the action. Rezel looked jealous, as did her venerance. Azul's immolents were impassive, remaining fixed while they waited for her to resolve the outcome. She didn't hesitate to do so, looking past Pick and Benhill and the Freejacks. She had done what needed to be done, what the situation demanded. No more, no less. She walked over to where the immolents stood. Their faces were hidden behind black masks, but she knew from the one she had killed that they were likely little more than children, and not much older than Haley.
As per the terms of our agreement, I expect that Azul's ships will be turned over to me immediately and in their present condition.
One of the immolents bowed its head and then pointed to the sky. Abby turned to look, finding a single...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.